Monday, 1 p.m., and as always, at least for the last year, this is POSPO and Braincast for Mostly Learning. Can you feel the heat? Because I certainly do. Trapped in my office with a tiny fan under these temperatures is like trying to be honest, I don't even know what it is like, but it's certainly sweaty. To the extent that I got pretty jealous of my speakers last week, as I'm pretty sure the weather in Edinburgh should be a tiny bit cooler. And of course, I'm referring to two of the world experts in functional neurological disorders that graced Braincast with their appearance last week, Professors Alan Carson and John Stone. Yes, of course, we did talk about FND. And if you missed it, do yourself a favor and watch the video on YouTube. If you're not a visual type, then head to Spotify for the audio recording. This week, though, we fly overseas to New York City. We take the train north of Manhattan that takes us to Bronx and Fordham University that our next guest calls home. Well, she doesn't live in there. Though truth is that for many researchers, the lab is a kind of a second home, right? At the forefront of the psychiatric epigenetics research, she has been places. University of Illinois, Chicago, Columbia University, and the Icahn School of Medicine at Mount Sinai in New York City. In 2015, she was awarded the NARSAD Young Investigator Award by the Brain and Behavioral Research Foundation that helped her establish her own research laboratory. You would be thinking, what do they do there? Well, funded by the National Institute of Mental Health, her lab focuses on hormonal and environmental factors driving sex differences in psychiatric disorders. So, inspired by that, I thought it would be a good idea to talk about the female brain. Braincast people, Dr. Maria Kundakovic, an assistant professor in the Department of Biological Sciences at Fordham University. Maria, welcome to Braincast.
Thank you very much, POSPO, and this is really a great pleasure to be here, and thank you for having me here.
So, Maria, males and females. So while there are certainly way more things that we have in common, we also have a few differences too, right? And while we could spend months, debating this, let's focus on the brain. One way that scientists describe, if you like, differences in the same structure between males and females, it can be called sexual dimorphism. So before we even touch on humans, so what does research show us in the animal kingdom? Are there any differences in animals?
So as you said, we can talk about this for hours, right? But I'll try to be concise, and I would like to say that this historically, this field actually started with these reproductive related behaviors in brain regions, right? And this is where people were starting to see some big sex differences, which we're quite expecting because these were regions, as I said, related to, sexual behavior, maternal behavior, aggression, and so on and so forth. And I have to say there are some, nuclei in the, hypothalamus of rodents that actually might be three times bigger in males than in female rodents, right? However, as this field extended, we now know that there are many differences in the area that pretty much have nothing to do with reproduction, right? And to give an example, for instance, my lab is very much focusing on the ventral hippocampus, which is in the rodents actually very important for the regulation of emotion behavior or anxiety-related behaviors. So we see differences among sexes in, behavior that are driven by this ventral hippocampus, such as anxiety-related behaviors. We see differences in the structure, and we also see something that I would be very happy to talk about, later on, in chromatin or gene expression, right? Wow. And these are all the differences that I think are quite important for when we talk about brain function and behavior. But I do want to immediately actually be very open with the audience, because I think what is also important to emphasize here is that we don't really know that much about the sex differences, because a lot of studies for decades in neuroscience were actually focused on the male brain. Believe it or not, but there were meta-analyses that were actually showing that for every five male animals, there is one female animal that was studied, right? Yeah. So I think we need more research, and this is I think we will have a chance to talk about that in a moment. There is now NIH or National Institute of Health in the United States has these mandates to actually include the females in research, you know, pretty much for everything. I mean, both sexes, let's say it this way, but it's targeted toward females because a lot of people are studying it in males only. And I think this is very appropriate for our topic when we are going to talk about the female brain. Another thing that I just wanted to point out is that my lab is actually focusing on within females, like how hormonal changes, which is actually part of the estrous cycle, which is the equivalent of the menstrual cycle in rodents, how there's some plasticity in the brain and in chromatin, as I will tell you a little bit more in a moment, that are really important. And what is also important to mention here, sometimes we really have to distinguish these two phases of the estrous cycle in the female animal to be able to see differences between females and males, right? So there's a lot of stuff that actually need to be done, but yes, there are a lot of sex differences and we need to learn much more about it.
Fascinating. So let's move to humans then and start with the obvious size. I mean, too many key papers out there by the Canadians and Aristotle Voinescu's group, and more recently by Martin Lotzek, who described differences in gray matter brain volume in a 2019 paper published in Nature Scientific Reports. Now, before we start contemplating if it matters, what are the key differences between a male and a female human brain?
Yeah. So as you've already pointed out, there are findings, there are very different findings, and some of them are not very consistent between each other. I think the most consistent finding really is that there is a difference in size, that the male brain is bigger than female brain. That also is actually correspond to the difference in body size, I would say. And then there were studies like, you know, some, you know, the first studies were done in a smaller sample sizes, and then people would say these are underpowered, right? And then there are studies now done in thousands of human beings. And if you can say that, like, you know, there are studies showing there are differences in, let's say, the density or gray matter, like, you know, in females versus males in certain brain areas. I am specifically most interested in let's say limbic areas that are important for emotion regulation. But as you know, probably there was actually very recent meta-analysis showing that like these differences are really very subtle. And some of them like not really exist after you control for the brain size. I do want to say, as someone who's a molecular biologist, I think like our expectations from these studies of brain structure are too high somehow, if you know what I mean, right? I think like, you know, yeah, we are seeing subtle changes in brain structure, and I think that's fair enough to say. I think there are changes for sure. And one important thing is like that we don't really understand very much the relationship between the structure and function, which I think is really important, right? And that's something that like, you know, I think overemphasizing that there are not like a huge difference. I mean, yes, there is no 2 times bigger hippocampus than you know, in female than in male. But I think these subtle changes can actually translate to changes in brain function. And again, there is a possibility. And I there's another thing that I wanted to actually say to your audience, because I think that's sometimes confusing to people. And that is that sometimes you might not even see the difference in behavioral phenotype. Sometimes you might not see the difference in the structural phenotype, but the molecular strategy through which, like, you know, female and brain and male brain actually come to the same behavioral endpoint or same structural endpoint might be actually different. And this is something that is particularly interesting to us for the people, and I think your audience is actually very interested in psychiatry, because we know that there are huge sex bias in many brain disorders. And, you know, if, for instance, there is some kind of subtle change, but in response to, let's say, stress or something, there is activation that is different in females versus males, this can actually help us understand, you know, these sex bias in brain disorders and lead us to some sex-specific therapy. So as a molecular biologist, this is where I'm interested in particularly. And I think people should also be aware, even if you show that there is a difference in brain structure, what do you do about that? Like, you know, therapeutically speaking, right? I mean, you really have to find some kind of a molecular difference and some kind of a target that would be sex specific in order to think about some sex specific therapies. Other than that, just seeing the difference in brain structure wouldn't be sufficient actually for us to make some kind of a good strategy. But it's very informative, and I feel we do need all of this information. And of course, I can be a molecular and experimental neuroscientist, but you know, we can't actually move without really some good studies in humans. And you know, these are just complementary you know, evidence that we need in order to understand the brain.
Amazing. I mean, you know, already have so many questions. Just, you know, just hearing you talk, have so many questions. So let's move to function. And although, you know, it would require a leap of faith to suggest link between size, structure, and function, an older meta-analysis by Jennifer Stevens showed how brain activation patterns to emotional stimuli differ between male and female. So what else has been shown to be different in terms of function in the brain between male and female? If you can summarize before we move on into all these amazing points you raised.
Yeah, I think one of the interesting things is, like, you know, that there were also differential activation in response to stress. I think that's something that is important. And again, something that, you know, people talk about these strategies, right? I mean, the different pathways and different brain regions being activated that can sometimes translate, as I said, into different behavioral endpoints, sometimes not necessarily, but it's important to know about these things. And I think, again, because we are focusing here on the female brain, I would really like to say a couple of things about that, because I think, again, maybe your audience is not aware about that. And we talk about human brain structure and function. I have to say that there are studies that actually are showing that there is a difference in the gray matter across the astrocycle. And there are differences in the activation of the hippocampus across the astrocycle. It's also in response to some kind of stressful stimuli. So that's something where, you know, I kind of, my lab is actually functioning, trying to understand if there is this plasticity in the female brain that is very specific to the female brain, because we are talking about female specific phenomena. Can we use this information to actually lead us to, you know, studies in animals that can actually help us better understand what's happening in humans, and then again leads to some kind of sex-specific therapy? This is something that I've been interested in. But again, if we talk about function in general, we also have to be aware that, like, you know, our functional studies are currently just, if we talk about functional MRI and similar studies, it's like, you know, it's actually based on, like, our, you know, like, following the, you know, oxygen or you know, glucose consumption in response to certain tasks or something like that. So that, again, sex differences within female differences that are very interesting, we have to make sense of it. That's something that I think is important, right?
Of course. And you know, the main question is why. So what drives these changes? I mean, you know, one obvious explanation would be hormones, right? For example, you know, back in 2012, Michael Lombardo showed how fetal testosterone in humans influences specific brain regions that later develop in a sexually dimorphic fashion. So I'm guessing hormones is an obvious one. And already you did mention a bit about the estrogen cycle. So tell me a bit more.
Yeah. So we know there's, like, this classical theory, right? I mean, that is now being a little bit expanded, both genes and hormones. Right. And I'll try to be very, you know, like, concise, but this is very complex, actually, topic. So typically we know that female development is the default development. Right. But because males have XY chromosomes complement, right, when we talk about sex chromosome, and females have XX. If you have Y, there is a gene that is called SRY. It's sex determining gene. At certain point of development, this gene has to be expressed in order for testes to develop. For testosterone to start being secreted, right? And this is, like, you know, a critical point. If this doesn't happen, the ovaries will develop and the female brain will develop, right? But if the testosterone actually is secreted, that will lead to the actual masculinization of the brain and defeminization of the brain, right? In rodents, we know it's actually testosterone is converted to estrogen, which is very interesting because estrogen is masculinizing. While, you know, in humans, we do believe it's androgens that are masculinizing. So that's very important part that we called organizational part, right? When that's happening during development, it sets up the stage for these sex differences. But then during juvenile period, typically there's not much happening. But then later in puberty, as we know, like, you know, there will be activational effect of hormones where now you have increase in testosterone that stays quite high throughout life in males. While in females, we start seeing these fluctuations that we call menstrual cycle, as I said, or estrocycle in animals. When you have this rising and falling in estrogen that will happen throughout this reproductive period, and then during the menopause and after menopause, you have a lower levels of estrogen and progesterone. So now both these parts are important. Like, you know, the organizational events during development are setting the stage. And then you have these hormones that are basically shaping the brain continuously later on in life. So what I wanted to say, for instance, like, you can study any of these events in general, but, like, you know, my lab is actually focusing on, like, how these cyclical changes in hormones in females are actually shaping the brain and behavior, right? I have to say the reason for that is because we know from clinical evidence that in terms of anxiety and depression, women are at twice higher risk for anxiety and depression than males are. And there is a clinical evidence showing that exactly when, if you look at before puberty, in boys and girls, you don't see any sex difference in terms of depression rates. Depression rates really jump to 2 times higher in girls only when you start seeing this fluctuation in hormones when there is, like, you know, a puberty onset, right? And then, you know, the difference between males and females in depression actually becomes smaller after menopause in women. So we are actually having enough evidence showing that these cyclical changes, and I want to actually emphasize, it's really not high or low estrogen or progesterone, it's these fluctuations, right, in hormone that seems to be actually important. And you can also see that, for instance, in postpartum depression, for instance, right? You also have, like, this sudden drop, right, that it actually is. Or we have premenstrual dysphoric disorder that actually is also related to you know, like, changes in hormones and actually sensitivity to hormones. So this is, like, what is a driving force. But if you ask me, like, you know, it's both genes and hormones. And I do want to say that nowadays we know each cell in the body has sex. So you shouldn't really be thinking about this early life setting up, but, like, that every cell in the body, like, it's female or male, have sex chromosome complement, right? And it's possible to actually respond differently. It's been shown in vitro when you remove the actual hormonal effects. So that's something, but it's like, you know, it's a huge another, like, you know, topic for conversation. So we are focusing on fluctuation in hormones during the reproductive period, let's put it this way.
I mean, you know, you already answered a lot of my questions, because I really wanted to hear that, you know, if these differences essentially underpin sex-specific vulnerability to disorders, and you've already mentioned something about that. So then let's, one thing that I have said to some extent, you know, luckily enough, we're not just stuck with what we are born with. And here comes epigenetics. Now, an earlier paper by one of the giants of neuroscience, so Eric Nestler, titled The Epigenetic Basis of Mental Illness, finishes with the following, that there are large sex differences in some psychiatric syndromes, as you said, depression, for example, and a focus on shared and different mechanisms of epigenetic regulation in male versus females is thus an extremely high priority for current research. And it sounds that you marked his words, as in your sex-specific epigenetics paper, you suggest that these mechanisms contribute to sex differences in the brain and behavior present throughout life, as well as in health and disease. Now, for people not really familiar with the term, so can you tell us what epigenetics is and why it is important specifically for the female brain?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so here I think epigenetic mechanisms are really, like, a good candidate mechanism to explain, like, how the sex differences are established and how they can be maintained and how they can contribute to disorders. So the reason for that is because everything that we think about in terms of the brain starts at the level of molecular level, right? So in order to actually make brain cells, you need certain genes to get expressed. It's going to be specific for the neurons and, let's say, glia cells in the brain, and will not be, for instance, like, you know, expressed, at least not at the same type of pattern in the liver, right? And this is actually already happening during development, right? So we are kind of establishing these gene expression patterns that are genes are getting turned on and off, and this is what actually leads to cellular differentiation. Again, why epigenetic is important is because it regulates gene expression, right? So we have the DNA in each cell that is wrapped around this histone protein. And this is important because you need to package DNA into this very compact structure. But this DNA packaging is not only important for packaging, right? It's important also to enable gene expression. So you need to open certain parts of the genome in order to actually express certain genes and then close others in order to silence them, right? So when we talk about sexual differentiation during development, it's very likely, and there are some studies that actually are showing that, you know, early in life, like, you know, you are setting up sexual differentiation based on, like, you know, some epigenetic effect and gene expression pattern that you are establishing, right? But what we are also seeing, and I would like to actually emphasize that, because again, this is something that I think is the most novel thing and the discovery that my lab brought to life, is actually that we are seeing that this is not only happening during early life, right? That it sets up the stage for later on, but that these changes are very dynamic, right? So we know, we have known already, like, you know, that basically neurons are very plastic in terms of chromatin and gene expression. This is important because, you know, neurons have to learn to, you know how to respond to the ever-changing environment, right? So you need to change gene expression, right? But we knew that in terms of, like, you know, a lot of these studies were done in only male brain, right? But what my lab actually had shown is that there is very female-specific plasticity that actually changes with these, you know, hormones. And because we are seeing changes in behavior, we are seeing changes in brain structure, and we are seeing these changes in chromatin organization, which is huge changes. Like, you know, across the estrous cycle, around 30% of the regions are changing, you know, DNA packaging, right? And this is of the same degree of the change as you compare females with males. So, and this plasticity actually can allow for these changes in brain structure and behavior. And this is where I believe it's actually a very a good opportunity to actually look into this regulator of this gene expression and gene regulation through chromatin regulators and actually find some possible sex-specific targets. If you ask me how much is known, you would be surprised very little, right? I mean, unfortunately, again, we have the same situation, right? In this field, a lot of studies that were pioneering studies were actually done in the male brain. Right, so we really have to understand more about sex difference, about these female-specific phenomena. And just to give you an example, like recently, actually, like whenever I have to write a review article about sex-specific epigenetics, it's almost more of a opinion article than review, I have to say, like, you know, because you have to kind of assume what is happening based on like some kind of logic. I was recently actually asked to edit the there is epigenetic series book. A book on sex-specific epigenetics, and they said, like, you know, the main editor said that would be so novel, and I would say yes, that would be, but I'm not gonna do it. Maybe ask me in 5 or 10 years, right? Because I can't really invite people and say, like, you know, now make up something so that we can write a book, right? You know what I mean? I think there is so much to be done. I think there is some also studies showing that there is the differential expression of these epigenetic regulators. Like, you know, there are, you know, in order to change chromatin, you need to change DNA. Like, you can do DNA methylation changes, or histone modifications can actually happen. There are some proteins that are actually targeting these DNA and histone proteins, and they can change the chromatin organization and everything. But again, while we know that there might be some sex difference in the expression, again, in terms of understanding sex-specific epigenetic regulation and how this contributes to normal behavior and psychiatric disorders, we really need to do much more. But my lab is actually focusing on this and trying to understand if we are seeing this huge plasticity in chromatin across the estrous cycle, and this is related to hormonal changes. If we are actually finding some, you know, chromatin or epigenetic regulator that is actually changing only in females, can we basically target that, you know, in a sex-specific way and change behavior? And, you know, so these are where the you know, like the ideas are. And I have to be very clear again, you know, with the audience, like, you know, I think not enough. Like, I mean, we talk about these sex differences, but in terms of psychiatric practice, we don't know anything about that in general. Like, you know, they're not sex-specific therapies. You know, people, like, I don't think any psychiatrist would consider sex or gender unless we are talking about postpartum depression or PMDD. And I think it's a huge missed opportunity. I think, you know, I've been to the conferences where people would show, you know, like studies of thousands of patients, like, you know, they would control for everything possible, like, you know, dose, type of drug and everything. And I would ask the question, like, you know, have you looked at the sex, the effect of sex? Have you analyzed your data to include sex as a biological variable? And they would be like, you know, not really, like, you know, so until we get really serious about that, and try start thinking about this very, very seriously, I think we cannot really think about sex-specific therapies. And I also wanna emphasize that, like, you know, if you think about, you know, precision medicine, I think actually considering sex and gender, it should be our first step.
Maria, you don't even need me. You answer all my questions. I was thinking to ask you about sex-specific treatment, but it sounds that, you know, we're not doing much. Now, there are groups of women's health advocates who believe that research in general has overlooked women's brains. So how can we change that?
Yeah. So I think it's not really only women's health advocates. I think it's really like the most important institutes such as National Institute of Mental Health and Canadian, you know, institutes that actually are the major funders realize that this is a huge problem, right? As I said, like, you know, we know there were studies that have been done, like, you know, for every 5 male animals, you have only 1 female animal. So women were, and females, in, I would say, preclinically speaking, particularly have been understudied. And like, you know, we have a lot of these things that we have to change, right? You know, we have to include females in preclinical research more seriously too. Because what happens sometimes is like someone writes a grant because they have to write it because of NIH, they include females, but then they publish the study in a major journal in males only, like, you know, and if this also, like, you know, major journals should change the practice, like, as well, like, you know, they should actually be very strict about this. And even if you do study only in males, just say it's done in males, and don't let me go into the meta section to actually realize that you didn't actually study females. So I think in preclinical study, we need to include more females, we need to do more female specific studies. And one important thing is, like, you know, in clinical studies, I think you should actually start asking questions. I think one of the very interesting now, things that are very acute, actually very important, is like COVID-related situation that we have with vaccines. I don't know if you heard about that, but for instance, there were a lot of women that actually, reported that there was like a disruption in their menstrual cycle due to COVID vaccine, after COVID vaccine. So that doesn't mean that they shouldn't be taking. Of course, everyone should take the vaccine, and, like, you know, I'm fully vaccinated. There's no question about that. But, you know, why no one in the clinical study didn't bother to ask a very simple question. Where are you in your menstrual cycle? Did you see any disruption? Because if there was like one box to check, women would know what to expect. Right, that you knew that to expect, let's say, there will be a headache, or like there would be like a flu-like symptoms, right? You know, so we really have to include this in our conversation. And I think you, as a clinician, someone who is closer to that, should actually start also talking. I think also thank you for actually asking this question, because I think this kind of outreach and like more people understanding these issues are really also important, so that we actually raise the awareness. But I think really in terms of research practices, both preclinically, we need more studies in females, and including both sexes, and, you know, doing analysis in which we will, take sex as a biological variable, right? And then in clinical studies, actually talking more about, female health as well, and thinking about also, like, you know, menstrual and estrous cycle. I think this is something that is really important, particularly for disorders such as anxiety and depression that we know are related to hormonal changes.
So let's add a bit more spice in the mix. So how can we separate the effects of sex, which is a biologically determined characteristic, from gender, which includes also societal influences?
Yeah, so this is an extremely important question. And I have to say, because I do studies in animals, I always talk about biological sex only. That said, my studies are actually then, I believe, applicable to all people that menstruate. And that can be women, that can be non-binary individuals, or that can be transgender men, even, like, you know, that actually are menstruating. However, if you want to talk about gender, that's, as you know, social construct, and that's something different. And for this, I believe we really need more studies. We need, again, as we just talked about, collecting more data. I've heard of people complaining that, like, you know, there would be like clinical studies wouldn't really have the information whether someone was transgender, for instance, or not, right? So these are like simple things, starting from like collecting the data, starting from asking people questions about their gender identity, and then trying to understand from the clinical and human perspective. And then we also can start thinking about something in animals. But I have to say, again, when I talk about sex, it's biological sex.
Sadly, though, and in typical human fashion, science can be misinterpreted. Now, a paper by Daphna Joel reads that sex/gender differences in the brain are of high social interest because their presence is typically assumed to prove that humans belong to two distinct categories, not only in terms of their genitalia, and thus justify differential treatment of males and females. In her book, The Gendered Brain, Gina Rippon actually begins with an 1895, many years ago, quote from social psychologist Gustave Le Bon, who used his portable cephalometer, essentially he was, measuring, how big is your head, to declare that essentially women represent the most inferior forms of human evolution. Or then in 2017, when Google engineer James Damore blogged to co-workers about biological causes for the dearth of women in tech and leadership roles. So what are the current dangers you feel of misinterpreting science that looks into sex differences, and how can we avoid that?
Yeah. So I believe we live in 2021, and we believe in 21st century, that we have confirmed that, like, you know, women and men and people of all gender have the same intellectual abilities, can do the whole leadership roles and everything that, like, you know, we can think about. And as a scientist, I think all these claims are unscientific. Like, I think I don't really like even to engage with this kind of narrative, because I think it's toxic, and I think it doesn't have a place in biology, for instance. And like, I think the people that actually have these claims should be, you know, this should be processed by some ethical committees in their institutions, to be honest with you. So I really, as a biologist, I don't like to engage in this kind of a conversation, because they don't really bring us anything positive and anything good. Like, and again, like, I don't think we have to have this conversation anymore if we had to have it in the past. And like, I like to actually just look toward the future and to see how we can understand these differences so that this can help us inform our future therapies. This is what I believe. Like, I don't think, like, really, you know, claiming sex difference, showing sex difference, doing anything. As I told you previously, maybe that's actually the best thing to say. We already know that there are, like, behavioral and phenotype or structural and points that are look the same in males and females, but use different strategies, the molecular strategy or pathway strategies or activational pattern strategies. So understanding these differences, I think, is really important to understand, particularly sex-biased susceptibility to disorders, and can lead us to actually sex-specific therapy. This is where my goal is, and like, I like have to have high goal. That's
what. It's interesting though, because, you know, there are some people that have, at least this is how they come across, a different opinion. Lisa Elliott, for example, a professor of neuroscience at Rosalind Franklin University, suggests that except for the, as she says, simple difference in size, there are no meaningful differences between men's and women's brain structure or activity that holds up across diverse populations. She even wrote a paper titled Dump the Dimorphism, and its abstract ends with a line, "The human brain is not sexually dimorphic." And truth is that there are several other studies in support of that notion, like the one by Daphna Joel, who suggests that sex category, whether one is female or male, is not a major predictor of the variability of human brain structure. So what's happening? I'm a bit confused.
So I think first we have here a semantic problem, I would like to say, because sexual dimorphism actually implies that there is qualitative difference. And it's absolutely true that there is no sexual dimorphism if you look at it that way. Like, you know, there is no brain region that is present in female but not in males, and vice versa, right? So again, like, I don't have a problem. People should show whatever they feel like, you know, if there is like a good science, if they do good analysis. I am totally fine with this idea that the differences are subtle. I think that we already discussed this. I'm also totally fine with this idea that there is no sexual dimorphic brain in such a way that, like, you know, it's, but to say that these differences are not meaningful, I think what they should really be saying is that at the level of analysis that we can do right now, at the level of resolution that we have, we cannot see much. But to say that these are not meaningful, it's actually misleading, and I think it's actually retard the progress of science in a way. Like, you know, because as I said, like, we see, like, you know, you come to my lab, I'll show you the data, right? I mean, we have a very obvious sex difference that we are seeing. People have shown, there are some consortia that actually have shown also like a gene expression differences across different tissues, including the brain, a huge difference, and not really necessarily only in sex chromosomes, but also in autosomal genes. So I think I think it's misleading. I don't want to kind of say this science. It's just like, you know, the way how you formulate, how you actually express your and interpret your results is really important, because again, if you kind of present this to the public in a way that this is not meaningful, a lot of people, you know, might actually get, like, you know, concerned about this, like, you know. But I think if we are scientific, if we just show like what we have, if we are very careful how we present these findings, if we are not making this big fuss about like what this means, if we are really focused on important endpoints such as, like, you know, understanding sex specific susceptibility to this orders, these all really make sense, if you know what I mean. But, you know, some people have some other agenda. Something's really good to be provocative. You get a lot of, you know, yeah, like, people follow you, there is popularity, you know, particularly nowadays, like, you know, when, you know, a lot of people, as we just talked about, there are multiple genders, like, people don't like hearing things that, you know, there is a binary brain and stuff. And again, we just have to be careful. What is biology? What can help us understand the disease? Like, you know, without really affecting anyone's identity or anything, like, there is really no reason to not show the differences that exist. Because as I said, like, if there are people that are having this fluctuation in hormones, which are women, which are like non-binary and, you know, transgender men that actually are menstruating, and this can actually improve their mental health, if we understand this better, what is wrong about that? But if you are like retarding the progress by saying, you know, this is like, you know, this binary thing is actually making us let's create some kind of a tension and unnecessary problems. While I think as a scientist, like, you know, as I say, like I aim high, you know, I try to aim high, like I trying to actually have like, you know, some really like a good goals and not really think about some.
Maria, we've run out of time. So yeah. Last question, you've been studying sex differences in the brain for many years now. Rather than asking you the last question about differences, I'm going to ask you, what is the most, if you like, lovable thing that we males and females have in common?
Yes, I think what is really for me one of the most lovable things about the human brain is its creativity, right? The ability to make some creative work. Again, strategies might be different in males and females, but this diversity of expression is really something that I think is beautiful. And maybe a lot of these people will never be able to understand at the molecular level, but it doesn't really bother me. Like, I think it's really something that that we should appreciate. And I think creative works are really something that I think is more lovable. It's common to the, you know, all genders and, you know, both male and female brains.
Amazing. Braincast people, Dr. Maria Kundakovic and her fascinating work on understanding the differences between the male and female brains and how we can tailor our treatments accordingly. And although you would expect me to say something like, next week we'll leave New York and take a flight to Sydney where we meet this and that professor, well, no flights next week. In fact, no flights, period, and not because of the bloody virus. All good things come to an end, they say, and that's the time for Braincast to complete this journey. A journey that started back in April 2020 amidst the peak of the pandemic with only one goal, to introduce us to lesser known parts of our most precious organ. I'm really sorry, liver, it's not you, I'm talking about the brain. I mean, who would have watched Livercast? A journey that took us all around the world, from Montreal to Melbourne, and from Geneva to Boston and New York. We met fascinating people. 50 to be precise, from all walks of life, from molecular scientists to philosophers, from neuropsychiatrists to psychopathologists. We even had the best contemporary jazz musician grace our screens when Shabaka Hutchings joined me last summer and explored the links between creativity and mental health. Yes, you can still catch up with all these episodes. Just check YouTube and Spotify. They're all out there free for you to watch or listen whenever you fancy. And that's only because Katie Moore, Dimejo Yebode, and Gareth Evans make sure they are there for you. Last but not least, a genuine big Greek thank you to each and every one of you that week after week would tune in to watch Braincast. Ευχαριστώ. Πόσπο and Braincast for most of the learning. Over and out.
Happy summer.
Happy summer.